So now let's talk about the second concept in hypothesis testing, which is the kind of errors that you can make while doing this testing. So there are clearly two kinds of errors that you can do. So first, let's assume this case defendant is innocent and the alternative hypothesis defendant is guilty, right? So to do that, so there can be two possible things, right? You can declare the defendant guilty when they are actually innocent, right? So which is basically the null hypothesis is true, but you reject it. And the second is your alternative hypothesis is true and or basically your null hypothesis is false, but you accept it, right? So that's the other kind of error that you can make. So the first one is called a type 1 error or a false positive or a false hit. And type 1 error rate is equal to the significance level alpha. So getting a higher confidence level and therefore lower alpha reduces the chance of getting a false positive, right? So the second one is called type 2 error, which is also known as a false negative or a miss. And the higher your confidence level, more likely you are to make a type 2 error, right? So obviously the higher confidence level basically says that your chances of making a null hypothesis. So basically higher your confidence, you would basically mean that you would not accept your null hypothesis. Okay guys, so now is the next part of the concept, which is type 1 and type 2 errors. So now if we again think of hypothesis test as a criminal trial, then it makes sense to frame the verdict in terms of null and hypothesis, alternating hypothesis, right? So null hypothesis is defendant is innocent, alternate hypothesis defendant is guilty, right? So there could be two kind of errors that you could make, which is declaring the defendant guilty when they are actually innocent, right? Which is basically rejecting the null hypothesis when they are actually true. And the second one is accepting the null hypothesis when they are actually false, right? So that's a problem. So there are two kinds of errors that you can make, right? So the first one is called a type 1 error, where you're kind of rejecting the null hypothesis even though they are true. So what can you do to kind of reduce that? You can basically say, okay, we can have a higher confidence level, right? Which means that if your p-value is extremely, extremely low, only then you probably reject the null hypothesis, right? So in those kind of cases, but the problem with doing that is basically if you kind of do that, it automatically increases the chance of making a type 2 error. So what is your type 2 error? So by the way, type 1 error is also called a false positive, right? Why false positive? Because your null hypothesis was positive, but you ended up rejecting it. So false positive. The type 2 error is false negative, which is basically your null hypothesis was negative, which is basically it was false, but you ended up accepting it, right? So that's why false negative. So higher your confidence level, so obviously you would basically end up making a null hypothesis. You tend to have higher chances of making a type 2 error, right? So even if the value is extremely low, only then you accept it. So that's when you would probably start accepting null hypothesis even though they are false, right? So that's why type 1 error, obviously we have talked about this. So this is the same example, right? So if you see this example, so type 1 is false positive. So there's a null hypothesis, which is, so basically you're making a false prediction, right? So false positive is that the null hypothesis is true and you're rejecting it, right? And false negative is null hypothesis is false and you end up accepting it. So type 1 error is when you reject the null hypothesis when it is actually true. We have already talked about it. Same thing. So now we come to the final part of the concept, which is chi-square goodness of fit test. So chi-square goodness of fit test basically describes whether before we get into the concept, chi-square tests are basically for categorical variables. So let's first understand that. Your z-test was basically for continuous variables. Chi-square tests are for categorical variables. What does chi-square test do? We talk about that, but there are two kinds of tests. The goodness of fit test, the second is independence test, right? So just keep that in mind. That's the basic difference from what we did in hypothesis. So that's what I was telling, right? So these are all just hypothesis, different ways of hypothesis testing. The underlying idea is same. You have an alternative hypothesis, you have a null hypothesis, you have an alternative hypothesis, you have a test statistics which you calculate based on your based on whether it's a continuous variable or a discrete variable, number of sample size that you have, and all of that. Based on that, once you calculate the test statistic, then based on the distribution that it follows, right? In case of Z statistic, we calculate Z score, which follows a normal distribution. In this case, we'll basically calculate the chi-square test statistic, which would follow chi-square distribution. Chi-square distribution is a different distribution. We'll talk about that in a while. The idea is that it basically follows a chi-square distribution, and based from that chi-square distribution, you basically figure out how strong. The concept is same. You're still trying to get the p-value of the null hypothesis, right? That what is the probability that these samples are actually valid samples given my null hypothesis is true, right? So you're still going to try and calculate the p-value, and if your p-value comes out to be lower than significance level, you reject your null hypothesis and accept your alternative hypothesis. So that concept still remains the same. It's only the way you would calculate the probability is going to be different. It's not anymore probably going to be Z score, and the normal distribution is going to be something different. So a chi-square goodness of fit test basically tests whether the distributions of sample categorical distribution matches an expected distribution or not. For example, you could use chi-square goodness of fit test to check whether the rest demographics of members at your church or school match that of the entire US, or whether the computer browser preferences of your friends match those of the internet as users as a whole, right? So you're basically trying to match whether the thing that you observe in a sample, the distribution of categorical, say 0 ones, right? And you basically trying to see if the same, this is a distribution very similar to the entire world, right? The sample population is same, the concept is same, except that you're not doing it for a continuous variable, it's a discrete variable. In working with categorical values, the observations themselves are not of much use for statistical testing because categories like male, female and other have no mathematical meaning. So tests dealing with categorical variables are based on variable counts instead of actual values, right? So all you're concerned is basically the distribution of the values, right? So this is 40 and 50, right? So say 40 males and 40 females that you observe in your school. Is that a very similar distribution to the distribution outside in the world, right? So that's the point of doing chi-square test, right? So is 40-50 very identical to what you are likely to see in the world, right? Based on say 50 samples that you have chosen. So now let's generate some fake demographic data for US and Minnesota and walk through the chi-square goodness of fit test to check whether they're different, right? So what we do is we basically calculate one national data, which is somewhere around 100,000 white people and 60,000 Hispanic people, black people, 15,000 Asian people and other 35,000. And we calculate Minnesota, which is a sample. And our idea is to see if the Minnesota population basically matches our national population or not, right? So this is your national table. So national table is basically what you see here, right? So this is the count and this is the corresponding table from Minnesota. Now idea is that whether this distribution basically matches this distribution, right? So you're trying to check for that. So chi-square tests are based on the so-called chi-square statistic. Chi-square statistics you calculate using this formula, right? So sum of observed minus expected square by expected. We'll just talk about that in a while, so you kind of, so that you get an idea of what is observed and what is expected. So expected is nothing but actually this particular thing, right? So you have corresponding national population, right? Based on that national population, you would expect something out here, right? As well, the same in terms of the same proportions, right? So if there are 15,000 people out of, I don't know, 35, 50, 150, 200,000 plus. Yeah, so there are 260,000 people here in national, right? So out of them in the same proportion, if you distribute the same proportion here for Minnesota, you would basically get some numbers, right? So let's see if we have those numbers. No, we don't have those numbers. So let's calculate that. So this is the numbers, 15,000, 35,000, 50,000, right, 60,000. And 100,000, right? So based on that you can calculate this is 15 by 260. This is the proportion, right? Similarly 35 by 260 and 50 by so on and so forth, right? You can do this calculation. So based on this is the expected, right? And so based on this, this is the percentage. Based on this percentage, you would basically want to calculate what is the number of people. What are the number of people in Minnesota? Let's check that. Yeah, so number of people in Minnesota are 600 plus 300, 900 plus 250, 1150. 250 and 150 or 400, right? So, so 1375, right? So there are 1375. So 1375, 35 by 260 into 1375. So this basically, this all numbers would basically give you the expected number of, say, Asian other people and Asian people in Minnesota, right? So you would basically get the expected number of all the people, of expected number of people from this distribution, right? So based on the national distribution, you can count the expected number of people, and based on that, even that is your expected, and from then you basically calculate the sum of observed minus expected. So basically this is your expected and this is the observed, which is 75, some 150, 675 and all of that. So then you do O minus expected square, the sum of O minus expected square by expected, right? And you calculate this for each of these values and you sum them up. So this is, say, S1, this is S2, so on so forth, S5, right? Then you say S1 plus S2 plus S3 plus dot 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 S5. So this is your basically the chi-square statistic that you're concerned with, right? So you do sum of observed minus expected by expected square, and you do that. Now in this case, the count comes out to be, chi-square statistic comes out to be your 18.194, right? So based on the chi-square, by the way, chi-square test assumes that none of the expected counts are less than 5, right? So in this particular case, this particular column, right? These are the expected values. So none of these values should be less than 5. That's one of the assumptions. Similar to t-test, so the idea is as we showed, right? So the idea is very simple. So you have now computed statistic. Based on this statistic and 95% confidence interval, you get the, basically based on this statistic, you get the corresponding chi-square value. And based on that, you would basically see what is the probability. So the p-value for that correspondingly comes out to be for this chi-square distribution, right? So this chi-square statistic basically follows a chi-square distribution. To know what is a chi-square distribution and how it exactly looks like, how do you define, it's sort of like, so the way normal distribution is a distribution, so is a chi-square distribution a different distribution, right? It's just not a normal distribution. So just read about chi-square distribution if you want to. But based on the way we calculated CDF, and you have a CDF value for a corresponding Z value, here also you would have a CDF value for a corresponding chi-square test statistic. So all you do is basically figure out that Z value, and you basically figure out that the P value for this corresponding test comes out to be 0.01001, right? So which basically says that, yeah, that's a very low statistic, right? P value. So that probably says that, yeah, you have to go to reject null hypothesis. So in our case, null hypothesis was that they are basically same, right? Distribution of different races in Minnesota and across the entire country were basically same, which is definitely not the case from this test that we can do here and assume. In this test, we see the p-values are extremely low, which means that they are definitely different, right? So that's something that we can kind of understand from this particular, you can basically kind of do this also using this function called Python. This also is part of the stats module that is there. So you can do directly chi-square, you pass the observed values, which is the Minnesota values, and the expected values, which is the expected values as per the national distribution, right? And you pass these two observations, and from that you can basically get the same value, right? So that's perfectly fine. This is called a chi-square test of difference, test of goodness of fit, right? So this is a chi-square goodness of fit, where you basically have two distributions, and based on those two distributions, you're basically seeing, are they similar? To do that, what you do is you have the one distribution that you basically calculate based on the other distribution, what is the expected amount of count that should have been there. And then you basically compare this chi-square statistics, which is expected minus observed square by expected, sum all of those values, and you get your chi-square statistics, from which you can compute your, based on chi-square distribution, the p-value. Now we are coming to the final test, which is chi-square independence test. So chi-square goodness of fit was basically two distributions are similar or not. This chi-square test of independence is basically They're basically trying to see if there are two variables are related with each other or not, right? So independence is a key concept in probability. We have already talked about that, and we are trying to know if the value of one variable basically tells you the value about anything, other value or other variable or not, right? For instance, the month you were born probably doesn't tell you anything about the web browser you use, right? These two data, if we collect data of birth of people, right? The month people were born in and the browser they use, right? So probably they would be extremely uncorrelated, right? There should not be anything that is related about them. So that's something that we would probably be able to see using chi-square test of independence. Now, on the other hand, your month of birth might be related to whatever sports you play, or month of birth and sports performance might not be independent, right? So that's the understanding. That's exactly what we are trying to do by chi-square independence test. So goodness of fit was whether two distributions are identical. Goodness of fit is, hey, this variable is related to this variable or not, right? So chi-square test of independence test whether two categorical way, we have talked about that. So John wants to test if knowing land contour, which is the overall flatness of the property, tells him anything about the price, right? So is land contour something that is independent of sales price or not? So he has divided sales price into three buckets: high, medium, and low. And those are, so this is, remember this, we are doing for categorical variables, right? So categorical variables, if we are dealing with categorical variables, we need both the variables to be categorical, right? So sales price by itself is not a categorical variable, it's a continuous. So that's why you have to divide it into high, medium, and low. And then land contour basically comes in these four categories: bank, HLS, low, level, right? So there are four categories. Now based on this, you would be computing the chi-square value. And the way exactly this test is being carried out, it's not part of this curriculum, but obviously you can read up in the extra lectures how this statistic, what is the statistic that is used for it, and what is the distribution that it follows. Obviously from the name you can guess that this also follows a chi-square distribution, but then that's about it, right? So you really do not know how this p-value actually came out to be, right? In this case, what is the test statistic that was used, but all you need is the p-value is extremely low, which again says that the null hypothesis, which is basically the null hypothesis, they are completely not related, right? Which is false. So low p-value tells us that the two variables are not independent, and knowing the land contour of a place does tell us something about the sales price, right? So the null hypothesis was they are not related, correlated, and the alternative hypothesis was they are probably somewhat related. And that's exactly what the low p-value suggests. The low p-value again suggests that underlying, assuming the null hypothesis, which is that they are not related, what is the probability of finding the sample that we have chosen, right? And which is extremely low, which probably says that, hey, the null hypothesis probably is not correct then, right? So the frequency of distribution already reflects this, right? So that is definitely something that you can see there, that if your property type is, for example, level, for example, if it's bank, then your sales prices tend to be higher, right? For example, if it is HLS, it tends to be extremely low. Or if your land contour is low, then you basically have a lot of low prices, right? Similarly, if your bank land contour is level, then you probably tend to have. Here you cannot probably see much of a difference. So if it's level, it's probably equally distributed. But if it's bank, HLS are low, then they can clearly see that if it's bank, it's highly distributed. Its prices of those pr house prices are extremely high. Similarly for HLS, right? So HLS is hillside, so obviously that kind of now justifies that hillside values are extremely low. And similarly, if the prices are near flat level, so that's the conclusion that you have, right? So for hillside prices, the highest prices are actually low. For the prices which are at the river bank, I guess, would be extremely high. And that's something that, because of that, we can basically conclude that there's definitely a relation between these two variables, right? So that's about it. That's the entire lecture about hypothesis testing. So we have covered everything, starting from basic probability in the first lecture, conditional probability, different distributions, Z-score, central limit theorem, confidence interval, hypothesis testing, type 1, type 2 error, and finally chi-square test for categorical variables. A chi-square test is just another hypothesis testing but for categorical variables. Z test was hypothesis testing, but for continuous variables. So that's it. Those are the extra reads for you. You can also find other reads in the extra reads section. So now go ahead and do it.
Log on to GreyAtom's learning platform to unlock more free content. Subscribe to our channel and hit the bell icon for regular updates.